We just had a Bethlehem senior high mission team lead this last week. They did some great work, and they produced a little short video, about a 3-minute video that shows some of the work they did. And so I asked Peter to download it and play it for us. So we're going to keep ready for the footage. Thank you.
welcome to our worship today. We're so glad that you're here to join the family at Cedar Creek. We're so glad that you've heard the voice of the Lord say, come on and worship with my family today. Today we know that the canopy of heaven is open for you. Whatever your need is, whether it's financial, whether it's physical, whether it's emotional, whatever the need, the answer in Christ is always yes. Always yes. Your Heavenly Father is waiting for you with outstretched arms to say, I'm glad you're here today. You're my favorite here. Glad you're here. Today, Pastor Harrell, I'm sure, told you that we have a potluck. If you didn't know we were having a potluck, that's all right. Other people knew and they brought a ton of food. We've got it running over, so please stay, even if you didn't bring anything. You know, it's a big, big house. It's a big, big table with lots and lots of food. So we ask you to join us. Now we're ready to start our worship because we're not just a club. We don't just meet here. We just pay our dues. No, we come to be in living contact with God our Father, with Jesus our Savior, the Creator of everything, is here to be with you today. Our hymn of praise is Pounding with Many Crowns, and we'll begin with our opening praise. What a beautiful name. Let's stand as we welcome the presence of the one true and living God, Jesus Christ.
Sin was great, your love was greater. The bell tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. You have no rival. Yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand. Yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a wonderful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
humans, we make mistakes. We fail, we sin, we let God down, we let others down. But the good news is God is faithful and just. He will forgive us if we will confess. We do that in the form of silence, and then we'll say our response. We must try to be prayed and confess. Father, you pray our confession, and that by your grace, the grace of your command be upon us.
Oh,
The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God who called me here below will be forever mine.
Will be.
Thank you. scripture today is from Matthew, the 17th chapter, beginning with the 14th verse, and that is found on 15:25. The healing of a boy with a demon. When they came to the crowd, a man approached Jesus and knelt before him. Lord, have mercy on my son, he said. He has seizures and is suffering greatly. He often falls into the fire or into the water. I brought him to your disciples, but they could not heal him. Oh, unbelieving and perverse generation, Jesus replied. How long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy here to me. Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of the boy, and he was healed from that moment. Then the disciples came to Jesus in private and asked, why couldn't we drive it out? He replied, because you have so little faith. I tell you the truth, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. When they came together in Galilee, he said to them, the Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of men. They will kill him. And on the third day, he will be raised to life. And the disciples were filled with grief. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Ms. Andrew, of course, this morning. This morning's message title is Mountain Moving Faith. Let's face it, this is one of those topics that can make us firm in our seat if we aren't completely in tune with what God says about the topic. Faith can be a funny thing. A lot of times people feel that it comes and goes, depending on the situation that they're facing. But as Becky pointed out last week, that's simply not the case at all. You see, when we were born again, we were given the fruits of the Spirit. One of those fruits is faithfulness. So God has given us faith. And not only has he given it to us, but he has given us an abundant proportion that can and will take care of any and all situations that we as Christians might come across. We're going to focus on a couple of different verses this morning. First is Matthew 17, verse 20. It's one of Andrew's read. Jesus speaking to his disciples after they were unable to heal a boy from seizure, and he was happy. The disciples asked Jesus, why couldn't we drive it out? Jesus responded in this way. He said, because you have so little faith. To tell you the truth, you have faith as small as a mustard seed. You can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible to you. As Andrew read the scripture this morning, we heard Jesus say, that this type of seizure was from a satanic spirit. And in verse 18, Jesus rebuked the demon, and the boy was healed. So why couldn't the disciples drive out this particular demon? It wasn't because they didn't have the power to do so, because earlier in Matthew chapter 10, verse 1, it says this, Jesus called his 12 disciples to him, and he gave them the authority to drive out evil spirits and to heal every disease. They weren't without the power that they needed. It was only a lack of faith on their part. The Bible isn't completely clear as to why the disciples lacked faith. Maybe they doubted their commission. Maybe they felt like their power had expired with their first mission. Whatever the reason, they lacked the proper power. At that moment, and that's the important part right here, they lacked the proper faith at that moment to drive out the seizures from this boy. Now, Mark chapter 9 has another account of this story. It contains a few more details than in Matthew childhood, the father answered. It has often thrown him into fire or water to heal him. But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us. Of course, Jesus replied, if you can. Everything is possible for him who believes. Immediately the boy's father exclaimed, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. So after this, Jesus rebuked the demon. The boy was healed. Now, back to those disciples. We've all heard this saying before. If you first don't succeed,
try again.
And practice makes
perfect.
This was the case for the disciples. As all throughout the book of Acts and beyond, it speaks of them using their power to do exactly what Jesus did. Now, I tried to emphasize earlier that at that moment, the disciples lacked faith. But as they grew in their relationship with God, and began to realize what kind of power they had and how to use it, they became exactly what Jesus wanted them to be. They didn't give up. They pressed on through their early struggles. That's something that we have to keep in mind when we are trying to grow our faith. We must remember that we don't learn as much when everything works out as we planned, as we do when things go wrong. It's when we are surprised and commit that by something didn't work out that we learn the most. When things don't go as planned, what do we do? Well, what we should do is go back to the drawing board, see what went wrong, and study why it happened, how it happened, and come up with ways to make sure that it doesn't happen again. As we get into the next part of the message today, we have to understand that when things don't go as planned, we must press on and keep fighting to achieve the plans and goals that God has for each of our lives. As we move forward in the message, we're going to focus on three ways that we can move beyond our unbelief and begin to live a true, faith-filled life. The first is changing the way we pray. The second is speaking words of life into our situations. And lastly, understanding as Christians what we're supposed to do with the written word. In other words, what has to happen when we read the word to give us the mountain-moving faith that we desire. So, why do we need to change the way we pray? Well, if you're like me, we spend most of our time in prayer asking God to help us or asking him to move on our behalf. That is a perfectly good way to pray. But today, in this step, we want to discuss a better way to pray. Any of you guys have read the Angry Woman book when I was out before this is coming from? Instead of us talking to God about the problems he is already aware of, or all the needs and wants that we have in our life, we need to turn that around. We need to start telling our problems how big our God is. Start speaking the word of God over those issues. God already knows everything that's going on in our lives. He doesn't need a play-by-play of how bad we have it, what problems we're needing. We know what the Word God says. God is for us, not against us. He wants what is best for each and every one of us. He wants us to be healed from each and every sickness. Now, if we truly know these things, then we know what God's will is in those situations. In the 8th verse of Matthew chapter 10, Jesus sent the disciples out with these instructions. Heal the sick. Raise the dead. Cleanse those who have leprosy. Drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. This is a hard concept to grasp, I know. But we have the exact same power inside of us that the disciples were given. We have the same power to heal the sick, to raise the dead, to cleanse those who have leprosy, and to drive out demons. We have seen many, many people overcome different types of sickness right here in this church. Those prayers were spoken by believers, just like yourself. Think back to last week. Right after the sermon time, the elders of the church came up, and we prayed for Miss Carol. We prayed that her heart would go back into rhythm without a need for a shock. And I realized that Miss Marci was without a mic for part of that prayer, so I'm going to try to explain exactly what happened. Miss Carol believed by faith what Psalm 51 says. In the 10th verse of Psalm 51, says, create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. What a wonderful verse of comfort for so someone who is having heart issues. So this verse is where Miss Carol was placed in her faith. Create in me of your heart. Create in me something new, not just what I have now. I don't want you just to make it better. I want you to create something new inside of me. After explaining what Miss Carol believed for by faith, don't forget the faith part. It's the most important reading here. Miss Marci prayed exactly what Psalm 51 says. And with the elders of the church in agreement, Miss Marci ended the prayer. So what happened next? We went back to our seats and finished the service, just like you. Miss Carol wasn't here, so we couldn't see any manifestation of the healing prayer that was provided for her. She may not have been here with us in physical form, but I can assure you the Holy Spirit was all over us as well. Just a few minutes after sitting down to eat lunch, I received this text message from Marci. I just received this message from Lisa about Carol. I can tell you pray for her. They have postponed the electric shock. Her heart has gone from 170 beats a minute to around 120. The doctors can't explain it. Why? The doctors don't have to explain it. We know exactly what happened. Now, could the doctors have shot Miss Carol's heart back in the room? Absolutely they could have. And Miss Carol would have been fine just the same. But tell me, who would want to go through the electric shock if you didn't have to? This is an example of Mount Moving Faith. God, through a believer's prayer, met Carol exactly where her faith was. The best news of all, that he is willing and able to do that for each and every one of us. The second way to help us move towards having mountain-moving faith is speaking words of life into our situation. And I'll be open and honest. Sometimes my lovely bride has an absolute field day with this one. I'm surprised the kids haven't started telling me, Dad, speak your desired results. They should. But it's so important when we are dealing with difficult situations in our lives that we use, we speak life into our in this situation. Christian singer Cobb, he has a song entitled Speak Life. And in that song, he speaks about just how crazy life can get and how much of a roller coaster each day can be. The song starts out like this. It says, some days, life feels perfect. Other days, it just ain't working. The good, the bad, the right, the wrong, and everything in between. He goes on to say this. We can turn our heart through the words we say. Mountains crumble with every syllable. This is the important part. Hope can live or die. We can crush someone's hopes and dreams with the words we say. But we can also bring an uplifting spirit and joy to someone by speaking hope, life, and love into their situation. The chorus says it this way. So speak life to the deadest, darkest night. Speak life when the sun won't shine and you don't know why. Look into the eyes of the brokenhearted. Watch them come alive as soon as you speak hope, love, and life. This one takes a lot of practice as well, especially if you lean towards speaking before you think. It's hard. We live in a defeated world. We've spent our lives listening to others around us talk about how nothing seems to be going their way. We listen to and read the news. It's like they have a problem trying to find good, positive, uplifting stories to talk about. Maybe all the negativity and drama draws in more views. But it shouldn't be that way for us. We are called to be different. We are called to be disciples to the nations. And as his disciples, we are instructed to share the good news. So speak life into your and your loved ones' difficult situation. Watch them come alive as they realize that there is someone there to help them get through their trouble. The last step to help us move towards having mountain-moving faith is learning what we have to do with the written word. What am I supposed to do with what I'm reading in the Bible? And this is going to go back. This is not really supposed to be part of this message this morning, but as I was preparing a sermon that Harrell did years ago, this is one of the first sermons that Harrell did with him and Marci came a long time ago. So but it has stuck with me for years. And some of you may remember it too. This is so simple, yet so very powerful. When we are reading the Word of God, we need to use the Cobb method. C-O-B-B. You remember him? He's dreaming. You remember that? Claim it, obey it, believe it, and bank on it. That's the four things. Claim. Claim the Word of God is true. The contents of the Bible are true and life. We must understand that the promises of God's Word are always yes and amen. Claim all those promises for yourself. God put them in there for a reason. Obey it. Live out what the Word says in your day-to-day life. You know the old wise saying, actions speak louder than words. We should always make the greatest of efforts to back up exactly what we say. Or we risk others losing confidence in our character. We can give someone the greatest advice that they've ever heard. But if they don't trust us because we have failed to follow through on a couple of things in the past, that great advice we just gave them, it won't mean as much. They will not put as much thought in your great advice, simply because of past dealings. So obey the Word and let your actions do the talking for you. Believe. We have to believe by faith that the Word of God is what the Word of God is, that it's true. We all know John 3:16. Here's another 3:16 which is in your mind. This one is 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy 3:16 says this: all Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. This verse makes it crystal clear. All Scripture, from Genesis to Revelation, was God-breathed. We have the Word of God only because of His divine power and the Holy Spirit. What else should we really need to hear? The Creator of this universe gave us these words so that we can be inspired to tell others about the good news of the gospel. The last thing is to bank on. This is the most important step as you move toward having that mountain-moving faith. If we're banking on the Word of God, then we're going to stand on it, no matter what is happening around us. No matter what our eyes are seeing, no matter what our ears are hearing, and no matter what others are telling us, we must stand on the promises of the gospel, and we don't back off until we have exactly what it says we will have. So what does it say about financial issues? Here's one of the many verses that speak about finances in the Word of God. Proverbs 10:22. It says, the blessing of the Lord brings wealth, and He adds no trouble to it. Needing peace about a situation in your life? About Philippians 4:7. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And you knew this was coming. Also, I'd say something about healing, right? You need healing from a physical or mental condition? How about 1 Peter 2:24? And by His stripes, you have been healed. If you're in need of healing today, stand on that promise. Pray. Meditate. Speak by faith that you aren't going to settle for less. We shouldn't ever settle for less. Jesus paid the ultimate price for each and every one of us to live the abundant life. That abundant life includes that prosperity, that peace, and that healing. Whatever it is that you need, Jesus has already taken care of. We just need to come to that point in our relationship with Him where we trust Him completely. And we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that if it's in His Word, then it means exactly what it says. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, please open up our hearts and minds to receive for this mountain-moving faith. Lord, let us read Your Word, Lord, and understand it for exactly what we're having prepared for. Pray this in Jesus' name. In your commitment today is number 270, I believe in a hill called Mount Calvary. Time out.
Time out.
I always wondered when would be the day that God would have to share the story with you. And when TJ was preaching his sermon just then, I knew today was the day. Last month, at the end of the month, I went with Callie and her group to the FFA. And I'm sorry y'all are leaving because I really would love for tensing up a little more after every phone call. And as we were coming closer to Newport, he kept saying, my heart, he kept saying, oh, I've got to take some heart medicine. But he kept talking on the phone and driving. He kept talking on the phone and driving. And we were in the middle of Newport when he said, he was actually on the phone, never hung up the phone. And he said, I'm having a heart attack. And he could barely get words to come out of his mouth. He could barely get his breath and get words to come out of his mouth. And I thought, he's either fixing to pull over or he's fixing to plow out some signs here. But I was so calm and peaceful through all that, and I know it had to be the Holy Spirit. Because all I said was, no, not today. So I reached over and I grabbed him with my hand, and I reached back behind me, and Callie was there. And there were six teenagers behind us, and they had no clue what was going on. That he could barely get words to come out of his mouth when he was having massive chest pains. I reached back behind me and I said, Callie, take my hand. Because I knew that whatever I spoke, that whatever I prayed, she would agree with me. And I know that my faith was enough, and I knew that I had the authority of Jesus Christ in my words, but I knew that if she spoke with me, and she agreed with me, that where two or more agree on this earth, that she'll be done in heaven. And the reason I know that is because it's in the Bible that God promises me that. So I grabbed her hand, and she grabbed mine, and I started speaking to his heart, and I said, heart, I said, you beat like you're designed to beat. You line up with the word of God that says that by his stripes you are healed. You beat correctly, you beat calmly, you act like you're supposed to act. Whatever's coming against him, you get gone right now. I said, we're just speaking peace over the situation. And God, you got this. You got this. And I was talking to his heart. And I said, we ask all these things in Jesus' name. And as I was praying, I felt two other hands get my arm. Because they knew, and they were agreeing with me too. And those kids had never been in a situation like that where they spoke to someone's heart. They never knew that somebody could do that. But they knew that something powerful was happening right then. And as I ended my prayer, he said, it's better. It's all gone. He said, it's back normal now. And those two kids that were behind me, they said, we've never seen anything like that before. Miss Stephanie, you brought God with you. And I said, yeah. Wherever I go, I said, you all can do the same thing. You all can speak over a situation like that. This doesn't have to happen. You guys can take care of that wherever you are, because you have the authority of Christ living inside you. All it takes is faith and God's words and believing his promises. And those two kids that were behind me that were beside Calvary, they were changed forever that day, because they knew that they could speak with authority too. And the kids behind, they got kind of quiet because they knew that something was coming up. They knew that something was happening. But that teacher, whatever was going on with him, he just stopped and he was right back to normal again. And I knew that today is the day I was supposed to share that story, because it went right along with today's sermon. And I thank you all for letting me share that with you.
Hymn of Commitment, number 270, I Believe and Heal, called Mount Calvary.
Thank you. They don't know yet. So we'll just do a little bit of business with God. Rob Russell. Okay. And Terry Webb. And then Janice's brother, Ray. I don't know if you've been following that saga on Facebook, but it's just terrible. He had some surgery that was supposed to fix something, and instead it made him be in more pain than ever. So tomorrow he's supposed to see someone who is supposed to adjust all that. It's some kind of a device, isn't it? A device that they implanted?
The TNT.
Okay. All right. And then we want to pray for Ray and Ryan again and for Debbie. Roar, Debbie, we're so glad to see you. And of course, Harrell. And let's see who else I've got on here. Aurora and Gabe Goins, they are little children that have hand and foot disease. And then, of course, Penny and our nation. Anyone else? Their request. No takers? All right. Then you may start. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I want to give you praise this day. I want to thank you, Lord, that you just said, come on to me. Come on, let's just talk a while. I thank you so much for it. Lord, I thank you. Thank you that you never leave us, you never forsake us. I thank you, Lord, that your arms are always open, welcoming us home. I thank you, Lord, that you say that you've given us a future, and it's a greater future. Thank you, Lord, for all the ways that you take care of us, for the angels that surround us from the moment of our birth. We thank you for it. Lord, I just want to thank you this day for all these people here that have come just because they love you, because they want to be here, because they want to know you more. And we thank you for it. We thank you, Lord, for giving us your word, Lord, that we can depend on, that we can confess it and obey it, Lord, that we can believe it and act on it. We thank you so much for it. We thank you, Lord, that you call us to press on when things aren't going our way, but to continue to stand in faith until we have the victory. We thank you, Lord, that every faith battle gets to be a battle of victory, but we declare victory in Jesus' name. We thank you for it. Thank you for the miracles that we have seen in this church. Thank you, Lord. And Heavenly Father, right now we have some people that we want to lift up to you. Not that you don't know about it. I know that you do know about it. But just so that we can come into agreement here for total and complete healing for all. We thank you for it. We thank you, Jesus, for praying for it. For praying for us all to be healed. For all of us to have the shalom of God. Nothing missing. Nothing broken. Thank you for it. We claim it now in the name of Jesus. We thank you that here you are, is back with us. We give you praise, Lord. Father, we praise you that Carol Martin is getting out of the hospital, and we speak life to her. We speak life to Debbie. We speak life over all these situations, Lord. We speak healing to Aurora and Gabe Goins, and we command that foot and mouth disease to be gone from these children. I command you lethal disease to leave these children now. You are not from God, and they are God's children. And you get away from them now in Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, we pray for Ted as he has heart tests this week, that his heart will be perfect in every way, just as you created it to be. We command any portion of his heart that is not perfect to straighten up and line up with the Word of God, to be totally healed. We pray on behalf of Shane, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we speak to Shane, and we say, Shane, be healed in Jesus' name. And if there is any cancer in him, in Shane, we speak to that cancer now in the name of Jesus. And I command you, cancer cell, to shrivel up and die and leave Shane's body and take all the lying symptoms with you. We command the healing power of God to flow into Shane's body now, that he may be totally, completely healed and restored to health, and that the Lord will restore him the years that the locusts have eaten. We pray, Heavenly Father, for Rob Russell, and I speak to his mind now in the name of Jesus, and I say, Rob, you have been given the mind of Christ. Now command your brain, your mind, to line up with the Word of God and take the mind of Christ. As he is, so are you in this world. And Jesus Christ does not have dementia. Thank you for it, Lord. And I believe for it now. In Jesus' name. Pray for Terry Webb. And I speak to that rash from the medications he has taken. And I command that rash to be healed in Jesus' name. I pray, Heavenly Father, for Janice's brother Ray. I pray for Ray that he will be restored to health. I command his pain to leave his back now in the name of Jesus. I command his back to be made totally and completely well, with medical device or without it, to be totally and completely restored to health, pain-free. I speak it, and I believe it, and I speak to you, Ray, and command you to claim it now. You take it for yourself. Pray, Heavenly Father, for your intervention in that situation, so that Ray is able to speak forth the life that you have poured into his body. I pray, Heavenly Father, for Brad and Ryan. I thank you, Lord, for putting them together. I thank you, Lord, that you have great plans for them. I thank you, Lord, that you have returned them to us safe and sound from Hawaii. Thank you, Lord, for this new baby that's coming. Thank you, Lord, that that little beautiful girl is going to be the most beautiful girl ever, and she's going to be the smartest, and she's just going to be perfect in every way. And I pray, Heavenly Father, for you just to hover over Brian and Gregory and their marriage, that it may be perfect in every way. I thank you, Lord, that as the challenges of life come towards them, that they will be able to stand firm on their faith, because they will have you with them, Jesus. And a cord of three strands is not easily broken. And I pray for them always to be as happy as they are now, in Jesus' name. I thank you, Lord. I thank you for that miracle of oneness, Lord, with each other and with you. And we honor the lift up in hand. And indeed, all who are in the military now serving in places of danger, we pray for all that wear a uniform of this nation, that you will protect them with all the guaranteed protections of Psalm 91. 1,000 may fall on your side and 10,000 in your right hand, but it will not come near them. I pray, Heavenly Father, for Kenny's whole battalion, that in 8 months, that their feet will be on solid ground right here in the USA, the land of the free, the home of the brave, and they will say, we're all here, and we're all safe. who rule our nation will come together in one accord, and that they will be able to guarantee health care for our people, Lord. That you will enter into the deliberations, that it won't just be grandstanding, Lord. It won't just be who can play gotcha the most, but that they will agree to work for the benefit of the American people. I pray your protection over all who serve our nation, from our president all the way down to the dog catcher. I pray for all of them to walk in your protection and in your love. I pray especially for our president that he will be guided and led by your Holy Spirit, that he will open himself up to your power, Lord, to your wisdom, to your patterns of speaking, that he will speak life to this nation, that he will speak words that line up with the Word of God, that he will exalt you, Lord, above all. I pray for a great success for every godly endeavor. And I pray for our church, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that we are built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, and indeed all the saints who have gone before us. I thank you that each one of us has a faith history with you that goes back all the way to Jesus. And I thank you for it, Lord. I thank you for bringing each person here, for you placing your word in their hearts, for you placing your breath in their bodies, for each person here that knows that Jesus Christ lives inside of them and that nothing is impossible for them. I pray your blessing to be upon our church, Lord, that we may exalt you, that we may glorify you, that we may be a lighthouse to our neighborhood. I just give you all the praise and all the glory this day, Lord. And I thank you, Jesus, for coming. I thank you that you didn't leave us in this world without a Savior, but that you came to us in the form of the Holy Spirit. I thank you, Lord, that you promised